you put lights on. All What's up, guys? Frank here from Metal Injection. Mr. Doug Brown, the director of the film you just saw.
All right. Thank you.
Right on.
Dude, that was incredible. I think where we should start is, you know, there was so much passion put into that film that we just saw. How did it all start? You know, why were you the guy to tell the story?
I was the guy to tell the story because I knew somebody else would, right? You know, I think all good things need to be documented. Obviously, I think that, like, documentary is the ultimate artistic medium, and that it's tons of visuals and music and action. You can really do everything with the documentary. I was just finishing up my previous one, Never Enough, which was a documentary on collecting. And it was like, you know, I was just premiering that when I was toying with this idea. You know, I'm sure a lot of you have seen, like, Decline of Western Civilization, and you know, and you know, those are the films that I always grew up like loving. But there was just something missing in all of them, and it was the extreme stuff. And then black metal, fortunately, has been very well documented, but there's like nothing on grindcore, right? And to me, like, you know, it's one of my favorite genres, and it's super important, and it's political, and it's badass, and it's fuck you, and it's, you know, it's like all the things I love about music. And well, okay, I got nothing else to do. hopefully somebody wants to watch it. I don't know, it was like throwing dice, but I think it worked out. I don't know.
You did a great job.
Yeah. Cool, thank you.
Yeah. And you know, we've talked about this a bit in the past a couple of years ago, but it's always been my feeling that grindcore is kind of the truest form of subgenre in metal, because its aspirations are very grounded. You know what I mean? Nobody ever starts a grind band to be, you know, on top. I don't even think they start one to be in the middle, you know? But they do it anyway. And somebody who's told the story and dug so deep, in your point of view, why do they continue to do it decade after decade?
You know, I'm not going to pretend like I'm not a grind musician. Like, I'm looking at it from like a fan perspective. You know, I'm a fan first, but I also have the fortunate ability to, I guess, sit down with all my childhood heroes and ask them all these questions. But I'm also in a medium that is like the least lucrative form of film. Like all documentary filmmakers just lose money constantly, and we make money from like other filmmaking endeavors, right? So I guess I've always had this like kind of like a connection with grindcore, in that like I can't stop like making art, right? And you know, if I had $1 million, I'd just make more art, and I don't have enough time to even like use up that $1 million. You know what I mean? Making this film, like talking to all these musicians about how they had like such limited resource and finances, and here I am, like, you know, selling a couple records so I could pay for a hotel for a night so I can interview like Shane Embury, right? Like, it's like, I get it, because I think that if you are doing art, and especially as an outsider, if you're choosing to document counterculture, if you're choosing to make counterculture, whether it's paintings or like, I don't care what it is, like, if you're doing it from your heart, which you should do, you know, like, money doesn't even cross your mind, you know? So, you know, I don't know. Like, I just like, I want to bow down to grind musicians forever, because it's like this, they're born to lose, but they're always feeling like they're winning, you know? I don't know. It's hard to explain.
Right. And I mean, you kind of touched on this bit, but I know that we both come from a really, no matter what we do, we're fans first, you know? And that said, who were some of the artists? Because you have some legendary artists on here. Who were some of the guys that you had to hold back from fanboying on?
I never held back. I was just like, you know, I don't know. You know, spending like significant time with Shane Embury was like, I would say, intimidating for like a minute, because he's like the most relaxed dude ever. But you go into those experiences like thinking back to when you're hearing like from Enslaved and Obliteration the first time in your life, you know, and you're like a kid and your mind is just like melting out your ears, and you're and now he's sending me text messages like, hey, you want to direct a music video for us? And I'm just like, yeah, I could do that. Like, maybe, you know, like maybe Shane Ember. I've just come to realize how grounded everybody is. But yeah, definitely Shane Embury. Dave Whitty's like, you know, just such a good dude, but like somebody like Human Remains, and like he was involved in so many projects even outside of grind that I totally look up to. And of course there's musicians I wish I got a chance to meet, you know, like I could go on forever about like the Lee Dorians and the, you know, but at what point am I putting too many voices into this film where like it doesn't make sense as a narrative, right? So I also had to, you know, make some like brutal choices, but yeah, as you do. Yeah.
Right. And on that note, I mean, you know, it's easy for us to digest a film, any documentary when it's done. But I know that's not always the case because there's probably a lot happening behind the scenes. What are some of the biggest challenges that you had to face while making this one?
Like resources were actually not our biggest challenge because I had like an unbelievable crew that was willing to essentially just, you know, do it because it was kind of cool to do. And it was a lot of fun. So fortunately, like, you know, I think a lot of people have financial hurdles. And there was a couple companies that just like lent us gear. And a lot of our things were archival nightmares. And like, I really want to stress that, like, I personally shot 100 hours of interviews from 67 people from 14 different countries. There's 17 interviews that didn't even make it into that film. And for every interview we did, I transcribed word for word what everyone said in a near 800-page document to time code so I could, like, Google, you know, enslavement, and it would pop up 87 times, and I knew what film reel it was then logged on. So we have we had 12 terabytes of grindcore history. I have 14,000 photographs sent from every continent in the world. I had 1,000 hours of VHS and mini DV tapes sent to my house. And I just want you to like think about that, like from a perspective of like this high, like 8 times, you know, like just the grindcore, like a wall of them. And there'd be like days where I'd pretend to have a migraine so I could take a couple days off work, and I'd just sit at home and I would set up like 2 televisions and I'd watch them at double time like this. And every once in a while, like, stop, badass, what reel? Okay, write that down, cool, I'm gonna catalog that. And then we don't use it because we had like so much shit, you know? So like not a bad problem to have, but like with me and 2 camera operators and 2 editors, you can see why something like this took 4 years when I like, yeah, it'll be done next year. Yeah, right. But I wanted it to be done right. So I always blame myself. Like my biggest obstacles are just like me, just like, okay, guys, this is our last shoot next week. This is our last shoot. Okay, this is our last shoot, right? You could never be done with a project like this, yeah, when I'm directing it.
And I understand that you were, on your team, you were actually the only grind fan.
Yeah.
What was that like working under those conditions?
That actually was very important for me from the get-go. Now, my two editors, Steph and Rob, I worked with them on my last film, but my very first feature that I worked on years ago, Rob Fiddle was the director, and I acted in it. You can see me as a heroin addict in the movie The Death of Indie Rack, available nowhere. So we've been making films together for 16 years, and you know, it was like a given that he was going to make it, and I think like he's like, yeah, you like Metallica, Doug. Let's make this heavy metal documentary, right? Like, I don't think he really knew what he agreed to. And then he told me later, like, all of the montages in the film. Like, every time, like, we'd be watching it with all the music. I'm like, this is badass. I love it. You know, I'd come in, they'd do stuff and show me. I wasn't always there for that process. And then he'd be like, I just want you to know, Doug, we were listening to the Beach Boys when we edited that montage. We just threw any random grindcore track on, and it just happened to work. You know, like... I shouldn't have said that. Anyways.
Cred just went down.
Yeah, yeah. Woo. I like the Beach Boys, though. Badass harmonies. But I think it's important to have those people in the editing room who would tell me to stop nerding out over the minutiae of stories. Because, like, if you're a filmmaker, you want to tell a story. Like, storytelling is the most important thing. And, like, you know, I could sit here and like, yell at myself by saying, like, Doug, you didn't have Crippled Bastards. You didn't have, like, Masha Tazo or, you know. But they would be the ones that would tell me, but that's not propelling the story forward. So having people that weren't, I guess, obsessed, like, you know, we were talking earlier about, like, the metal injection. Like, you know, your need for more and more and more. Not everyone needs that, but for this film, I needed to tell a story first. So that was super important. I want to tell you quickly, I have 2 amazing camera operators, Alex George and Dan Wallace. Alex, after like, it was like the second or third show, like I went out for, you know, just to talk to somebody and I came back in and he's like buying a cassette at the merch stand. And like, you know, NoFX was the heaviest thing he had ever heard 2 weeks before, right? And then like fast forward a year later and he's like, Warsaw rules. Like he's, so I actually made a guy a huge grind fan now through this film. So I don't know.
Fucking A.
Success. Yeah, right on.
That's awesome. And, you know, throughout the film, there's so many revelations. And I know going in, you probably had just a slew of notes of where you thought you were going to go. And throughout the filming, I'm sure that there was a big reveal that might have changed the course. And I just wanted to, you know, where was that? What was that?
I guess for me, it was, we originally weren't going to include anything with Siege. And we weren't going to include any anal cunt. And... for those of you who know your geography, they both come from Boston. And when one opportunity popped up, the next opportunity popped up, and we had already kind of locked out a storyboard. Like, we write everything first, cue cards, it's super nerdy. And we're like, well, that doesn't fit with our cue cards on the wall. You know, like, we had that moment where we were so, like, well, we've already written this story, and we've interviewed X amount of people. And then all of a sudden, this potential, we're like, okay, I'll go do it. My editors were super mad at me, and we got the footage back. And, you know, I think that a lot of people always joke around by saying Tim Morse is kind of the star of Slave to the Grind. And whether you, like, love or hate the, you know, the ideology of what they stood for or lack thereof, he's an unbelievable personality, you know. And as a filmmaker, you're looking for people who can tell a story, right? And that was one of those things. I'm in the middle of his interview where, you know, by the way, I would ask him a question and 47 minutes later, he'd be like, and that's how I met Seth Putnam. Like his interview, like responses were so incredibly long and my editors were really mad and why I had to transcribe all that.
Okay, 30 terabytes of Tim.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Like it was out of control and he was like pacing around and we're like, okay, here we go. but Tim is like such a lovely dude. And for me, not wanting that in the film and then all of a sudden realizing why it should be in there. I went to the premiere of the documentary Montage of Heck, the Kurt Cobain film. A really cool documentary, and the director, somebody asked, like, why wasn't Dave Grohl in the film? And he then said Dave Grohl actually asked to be in the film, but it was too late in the process for them to have included him. And that, to me, was very fascinating. You think about, like, a... you know, anything to do with Nirvana, you'd assume that Dave Grohl would be, you know, very much involved. And part of me as a filmmaker has made that decision and not made that decision in this film. You know, like, we probably could have squeaked in Lee Dorian, but, you know, we had hit 3.5 years of making the film at that point, right? And it took us 4. Just to, like, think about, like, okay, am I going to do, like, another year of this? But early on with, like, Tim and Siege, it made sense. So, yeah.
Cool. Does anybody have any questions?
Very good question. Who would like to distribute it? Anyone? I want the back. Best offer, 5. Go for 5. Yeah. I have received some horrible offers, and I am very much eager to get it just shown by as many people as possible. You know, we're going to do this tour until like mid-October. I'm only doing a few more dates here and then like sporadic appearances as it just kind of plays on its own as well. And ideally by November we're going to be releasing something. We're working on bonus features right now for a supplemental film called The B-Sides, which is going to come with those who buy that, you know, those who want all those stories that my editors are like, no. And I'm like, please. And they're like, later. And then that's to me now. So, you know, if you're interested, like, stay tuned. We'll, you know, watch the Facebook page. Hopefully something good will happen. If not, I'm going to be mailing it from my basement forever, and I'm happy to do that because I just want people to see the film. So, yeah, good question.
Cool. Anybody else?
Yeah. What was your interaction with Nick Harris? Yeah, it's...
Oh, we should repeat the question.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah, so what was my interaction like with Mick Harris, and why did he decline? It wasn't a traditional, like, being declined, like you would think, but he was very... firstly, I corresponded with him was via email over the span of about 2.5 years and sometimes 6 to 8 months between responses. And I, you know, as a filmmaker, you end up contacting a lot of family and friends and like trying to get a hold of him. And he agreed to do the interview. And I had a crew ready to go. And then he just never responded to any emails, like forever. And I responded to him in a variety of, you know, ways. From passive to passive aggressive. I'm not an aggressive guy. But I also know that if somebody doesn't want to do something, the last thing I would want for them is to be involved under a scenario which they wouldn't have wanted to have been. And, you know, I, for the longest time, because, you know, I'm going to go on record and say Mick Harris is my favorite grindcore drummer of all time. You know, yeah, cool. Let's clap to Mick Harris. Like, because to me, his playing wasn't about precision. It was about intensity. Like, he was the most singularly intense drummer ever. And not having him allowed the mystique of other people commenting on him, which, you know, it's a different film because he's not in it. But it's the film I made, so it's, like, the best I can do, right? You know, would I have loved to have had him? Yes. Am I happy with the way the film turned out without him? Oh, yes, certainly. And I actually think that in some ways that added to the film. Yeah. But yeah, if Mick Harris ever watches this, you're a badass. Yeah.
Anybody else? Another one?
Yeah.
Would you consider playing the film at maybe other smaller film festivals or local areas where people aren't so, you know, I myself know a lot of people who don't know much about grindcore, and this is like, it seemed like, oh, it's a pretty good pool to like dive into for someone who isn't as knowledgeable about it.
Yeah, we've screened at 6 film festivals so far, mostly in Europe, only one in the States. But we actually, that is kind of the next wave. We have about another 8 film festivals we have yet to have announced. And those screenings are always really exciting for me because I'll have people come up to me afterwards and tell me, like, I knew nothing about grindcore. I'm never going to listen to this, but I appreciate it, you know. And, you know, I don't know about all of you, but, like, the documentaries are a great way for me to learn about an insight into another world. So to me, that is almost as important as showing it to the fans because, you know, like all the fans in this room, like we all come from different walks of life. We all like have different jobs or between jobs or know people that would probably understand us better if they had seen this film. Yeah. So very good question. I appreciate that because like that is definitely the goal. You know, for the normies, you know. Is that still a word? Did I just like date myself? Yeah, cool. Yeah, cool. Still and hip. Yeah. Yeah, I'm hip. All right.
We call them the metal muggles. But, yeah.
Out of all the interviews and footage you do have that hasn't been included, what was the one band, personality, whatever, you didn't want there? You haven't cut it.
Well, I should say, just to repeat the question, but you asked, of all the excess footage that didn't make it, what was the one band that you did want on there?
Mm-hmm. I am going to say, and it's not a band, and it's actually a whole genre that we cut. We had a whole section on porno grind. And admittingly, I am not a fan. I am not a fan of porno grind. Personally, hey, we'll fight later. I like to keep my music and my genitals separate. I don't know. That's just kind of where I drew that line. I don't know. But I like Discharge, and they definitely incorporate genitals. I digress. But it was a section that, you know, had a really nice argument. Cinematically, I thought it played well. But we also had to decide on what the impact of that scene would have on our gore grind scene, like which was all of a sudden not as shocking. But to me, gore grind has more of a substantial influence on the history of grindcore than porno grind has. So as a result, I thought it would be advantageous to remove a section which obviously has like some historical importance to it, but was taking away from something else that I think has more historical importance, if that makes sense. And I'm sorry if I offended anybody for not liking porno grind.
That's slave to the grind.
too. Yeah, yeah. Slave grinder. Yeah. Yeah.
All right, one more. You got another one? Anybody?
Last one, right on.
I'm always interested. What's the band that got you into the genre?
What's the band that got me into the genre? So, like, I was listening to Napalm Death before I knew what grindcore was, you know, and I was listening to them also at a time when arguably they were a death metal band, like Fear, Emptiness, Despair, which I think that, you know, I'm 35 years old. I think anyone in that, you know, like 32 to 38 range, you know, you're listening to that stuff that was like, you know, I'm sure we all had like Demanufacture by Fear Factory, and, you know, and but Obituary got me into death metal, and then, you know, you're reading the thank yous, and then like, I'll check out Napalm Death, and I was listening to that. But the first band that actually had like a blast beat in it that I realized that that was the part of the music that I liked was Soylent Green, who are oddly not like, I wouldn't consider them like pure grind, because they have a lot of those like Louisiana, like sludgy, like almost like a swing to them, which is super rad. But I liked the grinding that they did, right? And so that was the first thing I ever heard, and it was on a relapse sampler, contamination thingies, and I bought it because I liked the Dillinger Escape Plan, but then I ended up just kind of gravitating to the other bands on that CD as well. I don't know. It was so definitely Soylent Green, and that's why I personally also like bands like Pig Destroyer, who will include other elements of other genres in music. That's not the type of grind I'm always listening to, but I'm glad that it's there for somebody to like find an element and then get sucked into this world, you know? Because right now I'm just at home listening to like almost like noise. It's like, all right. Cool. I guess was that our last question?
That's it.
Question?
Ladies and gentlemen, Doug Brown and his film, Slaves to the Ground.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you for coming.
Right. Cool. Thank you. Yeah, of course, man. Yeah. Let's get some music going.